I'm Humaira Khan, as you can see, and I'm from the Institute of Bioinformatics and Biotechnology at the University of Pune in near Bombay. And I'm working with in the lab of Michael Cox with Khanvi Nego, who's a graduate student there. And the title of my work is The Role of SSV in Homologous Recombination Catalyzed by Reke in Deinococcus radiodurans. So I'll start by introducing the organism I'm working with. This is the world's toughest bacterium. It has been listed in the Guinness Book of World Records. And it is capable of withstanding an acute dose of rays of ionizing radiation without almost no loss of viability. And to give a perspective on this, to kill an average human being, 5 to 10 grains of ionizing radiation is enough. So you can imagine how tough this is. So why is DRAD so radio resistant? So there are a lot of characteristics which have attributed to this radio resistance of this organism. They say that it is extremely good at DNA reconstitution. Why is it so? They say that it has highly conducting chromosomes, so that after a double-stranded break that occurs in response to ionizing radiation, the strands of DNA do not diffuse out, and so that they can be joined together. And it has a high manganese to iron ratio in the cell. What manganese does is it sequesters out the hydroxyl radicals that are produced in the response to the ionizing radiation, which cause the DNA damage. It has 4 to 10 copies of the genome, depending on the stage of the cell cycle. This has been hypothesized to decrease the chances that a particular gene will be obliterated during a DNA damage. And most importantly for our lab, what we work on and what is most fascinating is that it has really efficient DNA repair system as compared to other prototypical DNA repair systems in other bacteria. So here are the DNA repair pathways which have been reported in DRAD, that is the homologous recombination, the extended synthesis dependent strand annealing, the single strand annealing. These two occur early on in response to radiation, and there is a non-homologous end joining which has been recently reported. What it does is it joins non-homologous ends, and this homologous recombination pathway, which is the most important pathway for DRAD resistance, and which I'll be talking about over here. So, the Reke protein plays a central role in the homologous recombination pathway, which I've shown over here. It is important for the SOS response, which happens after cell damage, to activate a lot of genes in response to the DNA damage. It acts as a recombinase during homologous recombination repair pathway. It is an ATP-dependent DNA binding protein. Over here, homologous recombination by Reke happens. These are the crude steps. Reke forms a nucleophile on the single-stranded DNA, and it recognizes the double-stranded homologous DNA. There is a synapsis which happens, and then in the post-synapsis steps, there are the intermediates which are formed, and which leads to a formation of a nick double-stranded new product and a dissociated single-strand. And over here, in recombination repair, as you can see, Reke binds to the single-strand overhangs. This invades homologous regions on the double-stranded region of other chromosomes, and polymerases, helicases, and nucleases are recruited to repair this damage. So one thing that became quite apparent early on in DRAD research was that Reke is extremely important for radiation resistance. As you can see here in this work, a stain with a mutation in Reke, there is a 70-fold decrease in viability in response to DNA damaging agents. Reke gene is extremely important for the radiation resistance of DRAD. And here I'll introduce another protein which I've been working on, is the single-stranded binding DNA binding protein, and it's very apparent that it is a single-stranded DNA binding protein. It is really efficient at binding out secondary structures in single-stranded DNA. People used to think it's an inert sequence. SSVs are slightly inert, and they really don't associate with other proteins, and they just are involved in binding to single-stranded DNA. But work in Jim Keck's lab here in Wisconsin has shown that SSVs are not quite that inert. They have been linked to various aspects of genome maintenance. They have been shown to interact physically with a broad array of cellular genome maintenance proteins. And what we are interested in is that SSVs have been reported to facilitate strand exchange by Reke. Deinococcus radiodurans SSV, it is slightly different from the prototypical E. coli SSV. It has two oligonucleotide binding folds instead of the four in E. coli SSV. It forms a dimer, whereas the E. coli SSV forms tetramers. It has been implicated in chromosome repair and is important for stimulating the DNA strand exchange by the kick. So the aim of my project was to determine the role of SSV in recombination reaction by DRK and to study the role of phosphorylation in the regulation of SSV. So we're talking about the role of SSV in recombination reaction by DRK first. So over here, this is the method I've used. This is the in vitro three-strand exchange assay. This is used to simulate the recombinase activity of Rec-A in vitro. As you can see, we incubate the single-stranded DNA with Rec-A. Rec-A forms nuclear filaments, and then we introduce the double-stranded DNA. There is a synapse formation, and then the products are formed as the recombination progresses. Here, the beauty of this assay is that we can monitor the recombination reaction as it's happening by taking time points. So as you can see, there is a single-stranded DNA and recombination has started, the synapses happens, the intermediates are formed, and at around 30 minutes, the product is started to form, as you can see. So the previous work in the lab has shown that SSV is extremely important for initiation of strand exchange. As you can see over here, the same strand exchange reaction with DRK and DRSSB, we show that in the presence of DRSSB, we can see the product formation, but in the absence of it, there is not even the initiation of strand exchange. So DRSSB is extremely important for catalyzing the DRK-SSB mediated. So we wanted to know what is the role of DRSSB in homologous recombination. So we proposed two models for this. One, that DRSSB removes secondary structures so that on the single-stranded DNA so that Rec-A can form nuclear filaments on it. And the second model was that DRSSB sequesters the displaced single-stranded DNA to drive the reaction forward. So model one. So as you can see, these are the secondary structures in the single-stranded DNA. SSB binds to it, cleans out the secondary structures so that Rec-A can come in, form a nuclear filament on it, and proceed with the strand exchange reaction. And for this, the experiment setup we designed was, we are going to use tagged oligos and we are going to use substrates with and without secondary structures and see how the reaction progresses in the absence and in the presence of SSVs. The second model is that SSV sequesters the displaced single strand to drive the reaction forward. As you can see, we take some nuclear filaments on it, we add in the double stranded DNA, there is a synapse formation, and we introduce the SSV, and it would bind to the strand which is being displaced and pull it out, and literally pulling the reaction forward. To test this, we are going to replace the SSV which we use in the reactions with other agents such as nucleases or other DNA binding proteins to mimic the activity of pulling the displaced strand. So the results. So as we all know, a lot of roadblocks we do along the way when we work and practice science. So what we are doing was, we are using untagged oligos at first, and what we realized that was these small oligos we could resolve on the polyacrylamide gel. So we have started using FAM-tagged oligos to monitor the recombination reaction, and we are seeing quite a lot of mobility shift due to SSB binding. So we have been treating the sample with proteinase K and SDS. Where we did a strand exchange reaction with substrate using which have no secondary structures. So over here, this is the double stranded DNA, and as you can see, the recombination is occurring as the time progresses. And in the absence of SSV, also the reaction is occurring. So we can say that probably SSV is required to remove the secondary structures so that the recombination reaction can proceed. And another interesting observation from this result was that after the formation of the product, you could see a lot of intermediate, heavier intermediate being formed. And you wanted to know what these are and what would be the structure of these so that it could shed a light on the activity of SSV and Rec-A. So the conclusion. From this result, you can see that the role of DRSSB might be to remove the secondary structures to facilitate the DRK nuclear filament formation. And as you can see, I've shown you previously that there are some interesting intermediates which have been formed. You want to see what these would look like, so we can speculate these would be the kind of structures that have been formed. And this will shed a light on that, how REC is performing the recombination reaction, or we might just end up realizing that SCD and REC are still bound to it. So future of, we'll be using electron microscopy to see, to determine the structure of these intermediates. Electron microscopy and Westergaard analysis will show whether SSB and DRK are still attached to these substrates, and we need to perform the other experiments which I showed earlier to establish a definitive model for SSB function. So here I'll briefly describe the second part of the project I was doing over here, that is to study the role of phosphorylation in the regulation of SSB. Post-translational modification is extremely well known in eukaryotes, but it has only been recently reported in prokaryotes. Reports have shown that single-stranded DNA binding proteins get phosphorylated, and a paper last year showed that they have discovered a protein kinase in DNA which is active and which responds to DNA damage. So we wanted to study if SSB really gets phosphorylated, the DRAD SSB, and then perform Westergaard and mass spec analysis to identify the phosphorylation in SSB, and to study if there is a change in the phosphorylation states of these proteins in response to radiation. So this is the workflow. We're cloning the SSB and REC proteins into DRAD1, these are the overexpressed vectors, and then transform these clones into DRAD, overexpress these proteins, purify them under different experimental conditions, that is in radiation, without radiation, and then use anti-tyrosine phosphate antibodies on Westergaard to detect phosphorylation, and then to perform mass spec analysis to see whether where the site of phosphorylation in these proteins. Till now we have been able to clone the SSB and REC protein into the overexpression vectors and transform this construction to DRAD, and we'll try and overexpress these proteins in DRAD and purify them and see if they are getting phosphorylated. I still have 10 days here, unlike the others, and I hope to get something from it. So, I would like to acknowledge Dr. Michael Cox. Hope he gets well soon. And the grad student I've been working with, Mandy Nigo, is doing really good with me. And all the other Cox lab members, my fellow Purana fellows, thank you. University of Wisconsin-Madison for giving me the opportunity to come here, and the Purana program, and IUSSTEF and DBT India for funding my project.